Haunting, ghostly trumpets echo around the volcano. Just a couple of miles north of the crater of Mount St. Helens sits a zone chiefly reserved for researchers and wildlife. Here, large herds of elk regularly crisscross the pumice plain. Their plaintive bugling belies their size.
For a big animal like that, part of that bugle is this shrill kind of whistle thing, almost like a calliope. It's a really amazing sound when you hear that out in the woods.
It could be an alarm bark, warning the herd of danger nearby. Most of the year, elk largely separate along gender lines. Bulls form bachelor herds. They're very social, more so than deer or moose. Often the males spar, but it's not serious. These are mock fights. However, the games come to an end during breeding season. Each autumn, the rut resumes, a time to jockey for more females by gaining dominance over other males, often by force. It is then that the hills echo with the music of bulls bugling their best love songs. A strong bull can attract a harem of 20 cows or more. Pity the young bull with only 4 cows who accidentally heads over a hill directly into the path of a much more successful bull. The powerful elk has just one antler, probably lost in a previous battle for dominance. The cows idle nearby to watch a battle for their affections. Even one antler is enough to intimidate. This time, the confrontation takes only a moment. The younger bull gives up his cows without a fight.
And that's enough for that other elk that would be interloper to turn around and hightail it out of there.
The young bull wanders off empty-handed. There will be plenty of opportunities to court again. Here at Mount St. Helens, elk populations have surged into the thousands. That's a remarkable change from 30 years ago.
Stop and think for a second. On May 18, 1980, all elk, as well as other large mammals, were instantly killed over an area of 230 square miles. Immediately after the eruption, there were no elk on the landscape.
No one really had a clue how long it would be before life might return to the devastated terrain. Elk were among the very first.
They came back in immediately because these animals are capable of traveling a long distance in a relatively short amount of time. But what happened is the population really, really increased dramatically after the eruption, far greater than anyone had anticipated.
Charlie Crisafulli has spent his entire career studying this volcanic landscape. He's a biologist with the U.S. Forest Service. He has watched as plants and animals return to the prime blast zone. Many of the trees that took root have failed to become trees because they're the elk's favorite food. A black cottonwood that could be 15 years old and 30 feet tall instead sprawls like a squat 5-foot shrub.
It's because elk keep coming and they nip each of these leaders. And as a result of constantly being pruned back and constantly putting out new shoots, instead of a tree growth form, we have this bonsai type of shrub form.
Elk have a profound impact on the Mount St. Helens landscape. In just 1 hour, a large herd can graze a patch so completely, Charlie says the progression of plants will be altered for a decade.
Of course, during the rut, the bulls just really knock the heck out of the vegetation through working them with their antlers as well as hooves.
More elk than ever seem to be heading for the volcanic mudflow zones down along the Toutle River. That's because up above, timber companies replanted the hills. The forest has grown tall now. Little sunlight gets through, so there are fewer shrubs below. Elk food doesn't grow well anymore.
One thing for sure is as these plantations have grown, the ability of Mount St. Helens landscape to support elk has decreased dramatically.
They're doing reasonably well, although we do know that nutritionally, this particular herd in Washington is not at a real high nutritional level, even going into the fall.
Biologist Brian Calkins works for the Washington Department of Fish and Wildlife. He says some plants are more nutritious than others, and the elk need every bit of nutritional energy to fatten up to survive cold winter months. Scientists go to great lengths to learn if the elk have enough fat on their frames.
Well, the chases are pretty exciting. They're short. We've got it down to a science. Shooting a tranquilizer, it's actually a two-drug combination. Trying to hit them in the large muscles, usually the butt.
Within 3 to 7 minutes, the elk lies down in a deep sleep.
We want that animal to be healthy the whole time. We want it to breathe well. We want its heart to beat well. We want it to lie down and go to sleep nicely.
A state Fish and Wildlife team moves in for a rapid-fire health exam, complete with portable ultrasound.
What she's doing, she's checking to see if the cows are pregnant, and then she's also checking to see how much fat they have over their back to study their condition.
There's a fat layer that's 7 millimeters. A lot of the animals we're doing out in the forest, they don't have measurable amount of fat on them, and that's typical for this time of year.
During two recent years, winter turned especially harsh. The elk burned through their fat reserves fast. Many started dying. Disturbing video of starving elk made the news and prompted a public uproar. The Department of Fish and Wildlife was pressured to feed the elk, which it did for two winters. But there are serious drawbacks. Feeding attracts more elk than ever to one spot. Then disease can spread. And the food isn't something elk are used to. Their stomachs may not be able to process it.
There have been elk and deer studies in other regions where these animals have full stomachs, yet they're starving and they die.
We're never really in favor of artificial feeding if we can avoid it. The second year that we fed the animals here, we actually had our highest winter mortality that we've ever had, and it was a very severe winter, and the animals concentrated here partially because of the feeding we were doing.
Despite the feedings, 150 elk died. The next year, when feeding stopped, the winter was mild. They found just one elk dead.
You know, the question is, did you save any animals by feeding them? And I can't really say that we can answer that question yes or no.
There's another key question. Are there too many elk out here for this land to sustain? To know, biologists need a more accurate count. So when they do a medical test, they often also attach a radio collar.
We put the radio collar on it, we put an ear tag on it, and then we use the antidote and wake them up. And all of that happens sometimes within 20 minutes.
It used to be that the elk would then lie for hours until they came to on their own. Now, a revolutionary drug allows the scientists to reverse the tranquilizer within minutes.
When they first wake up, they're probably a little bit groggy. When you see them take their first 3 or 4 steps, their steps are a little bit high, their head's a little bit high. But by the time usually they're 100 yards away, they're back to normal.
During future aerial surveys, they'll be able to home in on the radio collars.
The most important thing is that we're working on developing and refining a better population assessment approach here so that we have more confidence in our estimates of actually how many elk are running around on this landscape.
There's a lot less habitat for elk in this landscape thanks to the big floods of 1996. Nearly 300 acres of riverside grazing land disappeared.
Just washed away, washed downstream.
The state of Washington would like to recreate that land, but they're not going to just dump a lot of dirt in and watch it get washed away. This, they hope, will be land recovery in slow motion. They're building structures out into the path of the Toutle River, hoping to actually divert its course over years.
And you can see the material deposited on the upstream side of it, and eventually, with higher flows, it'll probably fill in below it, too. The structures, in a sense, are really a short-term measure to slow down the erosion here. The riparian zone is really the long-term stability measure that we need.
If enough sediment piles up and enough plants and trees take root to hold it in place, they just might be able to shrink the footprint of the river. This is riparian restoration, not for fish, but for elk habitat. Overall, across this protected volcanic monument, elk have done very well. There is one piece of nature's former balance still missing. Wolves. No one has plans to bring them in, but Charlie Crisafulli predicts they will arrive on their own, perhaps soon.
The wolves have been moving throughout Western North America, and they're likely to get to the west slope of the Cascades, and there's not a place on the west side of the Cascade Mountains that are more suitable, perhaps optimal, for wolves right now than at Mount St. Helens.
In the meantime, bulls face competition from the occasional coyote and from a small amount of hunting recently allowed in the volcanic monument.
Red 320.
Biologists continue their efforts to support the herds and restore their land. Mount St. Helens and the mudflows that stretch for miles downstream from the volcano have become critical winter range for thousands of elk.